The aims of this session are to introduce you to the saline process tool by looking at some of it and getting an overview, to see how medicine and dentistry give unique opportunities to share your faith. In dentistry in particular, if the patient's mouth is full of instruments, then they have ears to hear, don't they? To understand the barriers in us and in our patients, to know the five keys to spiritual influence, and to look at some tools that are useful in sharing faith. And the saline process course is aimed to be very practical, to give people skills that they can use. Now, let me just introduce you to the International Saline Partnership, which is a group of 10 organizations, of which ICMDA is one. There are two other international groups, HCFI and NCFI, and seven national groups altogether, including a group called IHS, or International Health Services Global, who help coordinate it. And all of these groups work together using this tool called the saline process to train healthcare workers around the globe to answer God's call to be a witness. As the Lord said, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and right until the ends of the earth. So this is about how practically to do it in healthcare. So not just doctors and dentists, but all healthcare professionals are being trained all around the world. If you had a chance before the session to read this, the link is on the WhatsApp group that you've seen already. And this was an article that was published just a few years ago in Triple Helix, which is the journal of the Christian Medical Fellowship in the United Kingdom. When I was the CEO there, we published this, and it explains what the saline process is and who the groups are and how it works. So it's a very good overview, very brief to understanding how it all works. One of the member groups of the International Saline Partnership is the Healthcare Christian Fellowship International, HCFI, and the founder of HCFI, who's with the Lord now, he said, every week more people walk through the doors of hospitals than through the doors of churches. And if you think about it, that's absolutely true, particularly in these COVID times. So people, healthcare professionals, doctors, nurses, dentists, and so on, have access to people, which church ministers and church staff do not, because people don't naturally come to churches unless they have good friends who've invited them, who they trust. But everyone's coming to hospitals and clinics because everyone will get sick at some time or will have a relative who does. And he also said, when you're healthy, you look out horizontally, but if you're sick and lying down, you look up vertically to God. You think about the meaning of your life, the future. You're much more conscious about the deep questions about life, the universe, and everything. When you're sick, you're looking up vertically and you're more ready to listen. So healthcare gives that unique opportunity, more people and people who are asking questions. And doctors and dentists as well are in a privileged position where they have access to an influence in an individual's life. So just think about this. A perfect stranger will undress at your request. A doctor can say, well, if you just like, you know, to remove these items of clothing, go behind the curtain, and people will do it without any question at all. That is quite bizarre, really, but that's the role that we have. Patients will tell you what they wouldn't tell anyone else, perhaps things that they're not shared with their own loved ones, their own wife or husband or family. You're held in trust right at the beginning. People come to you at crisis moments in their lives, perhaps when they're facing the prospect of a long chronic illness or even a terminal illness, and they're asking very deep questions. And they put their very lives in your hands. And I, as a surgeon, certainly experience this many, many times where you explain to people, well, you have this condition, you've got to have this operation, and you virtually never have anyone saying no. They put your lives in your hands and they trust you. So we're in a very privileged position. They trust us, they wait and will not get angry. even if they have to wait a long time, because they, you know, believe that your time is precious and they're really wanting to get to see you. They let you interrupt their lives. You know, you get offered an appointment to see a doctor or a dentist, you'll often cancel other things to make sure that you can get there. And they'll make major lifestyle changes because you've said so. Eat less fat, stop smoking, stop drinking so much alcohol, get more exercise. Nobody else can say this to people without getting a much less favorable reaction than a doctor or dentist does. Or they grant you credibility before you've earned it, just because you have the letters DR in front of your name, or MD or BDS after your name. They might not know you at all, but they've already granted you credibility, and you meet them when God is already at work in their lives. So we're in a very privileged position. Now, let's think about the whole process of evangelism. It takes often many years for someone to come to faith. Some people, it's a lifelong journey. Sometimes parts of that process happen very quickly. But there are three main stages to the whole process of evangelism. And the first part, if we can use metaphors or describing words from agriculture, the first stage is cultivating. That's when you're clearing the ground before you plant the seed. And in the same way, we can create an opportunity where people are going to be receptive from the gospel by building good relationships. And so cultivating speaks to the heart. And then the second stage is sowing, throwing the seed out, which speaks to the mind. The gospel is God's power for salvation to everyone who has faith, Romans 1:16. And then when people understand the gospel, the next stage is harvesting, which speaks to the world. They've got to make a decision as to whether they're going to respond to it and become believers or not. So there's a, just as in agriculture and the production of grain, there's cultivating, there's sowing and harvesting. And if you've done the Confident Christianity course, I know some of you are involved in that, then Confident Christianity is really dealing with the sowing part, speaking to the mind, presenting the gospel, apologetics. Whereas Saline Process is much more on the cultivating side. It's creating the opportunities to be able to talk about Christ. There are other courses which deal with the harvesting, you know, how you lead someone to Christ who's very close and is convicted of their sin, how you lead them to the cross. So evangelism is a process which may take many years. It's a process which is usually quite prolonged in a person, of guiding an unbeliever in the power of the Spirit, because it's something that God does through his Holy Spirit, in making the multitude of many decisions. We tend to think of the big decision of someone accepting Christ, but often the process is lots of little decisions along the way that are taking them closer to it, that result in the overcoming of many obstacles, and we'll come back and consider what those barriers and obstacles are, towards placing his or her faith in Christ. So that's the process of evangelism. Now, before we start looking at the subject of sharing faith with patients, there are three cautions that we need to bear in mind, three things that we need to do in any interaction with our patients. And the first is that we have to be sensitive. If the Holy Spirit has not opened a door for a conversation, then you do not barge through. You've got to be sensitive to a person's culture, to their condition, to where they might be coming from, to whether they might be ready for a conversation or not. Secondly, permission. We don't operate on patients or even give them drug treatments or carry out an examination without consent. So consent is absolutely key. And in the doctor-patient or the dentist-patient relationship, where we are potentially in a position of power or privilege over the patient, we have to be absolutely sure that any conversation is taking place with their full permission and consent, that it's something they're actually welcoming. And then thirdly, we have to be doing it with respect, remembering that every single patient is a person made in the image of God, who is worthy of the utmost respect and wonder and empathy and protection. So sensitivity, permission, or respect, the SPR of evangelizing or sharing the gospel with patients. Now, the saline process training over the course of usually a day that it takes, or it might be 6 one-hour sessions, or however you do it, deals with these five main questions. Why is faith important in healthcare? The influence of faith on health. And we're not going to look at that one today. What are the opportunities for and the barriers to fulfilling God's call? We are going to look a bit at that. What's my part in it? What tools will help me to cultivate, sow, and harvest? And where do I go from here? So we're going to concentrate largely on the second and the fourth questions here, the opportunities and barriers for fulfilling God's call, and what tools will help me cultivate, sow, and harvest. So there we are. That's what we're going to look at, essentially. Now, first of all, there are barriers to the sharing of faith. Of course, we know that we have a very real enemy in the evil one who is attempting to blind people's minds and stop us talking about our faith. And some of these barriers are in our own lives, and some of them are in the lives of our patients. So first, in order of frequency, lack of time is the first one. So over 70% of doctors say, look, I'm so busy. There are so many people at my clinic, so many people I've got to see on my ward round. I just do not have time for this. And the answer to that is to find the one or two people, maybe a day, maybe a week, maybe a month, where God creates the time. And actually, it doesn't take much time to make an impression and to share faith. It's more about how you use your time. Uncertainty about how to take a spiritual history. Well, we're going to touch on that. How to identify patients who desire discussion, because not everybody does. And if God's not opening the door, then you don't push it open. Or manage spiritual issues. What if I start to share about these things in some huge issue of past guilt or sexual abuse or a relative who was a Christian and mistreated them or whatever comes up? How am I going to handle that? Lack of experience or training, and that's, of course, what this course is all about. Concern I'll project my beliefs. Well, we've already talked about the importance of sensitivity, permission, and respect. Using appropriate language, well, that's just a matter of being able to put Christian concepts in words that people understand. And then some people worry too about the negative attitude of peers. What about if I say something and the patient complains and there's a complaint against me, and then I have to appear before some disciplinary committee or something? So that's, so we need to identify what these barriers are and see how we can overcome them. But they are overcomable, all of these barriers. And then also there are barriers in the patient's life. And so these barriers are of different kinds. Some of them are emotional barriers, where they just have an aversion, a strong feeling against Christianity or against Christians. They might be intellectual barriers, difficult questions. How can I trust a God who allows suffering or who sends people to hell? Or isn't Christian faith just psychological? Or how do we know the Bible's really true? How can Jesus be the only way to God? These are intellectual barriers, the sort of things that the Confident Christianity course deals with in more detail. Then there's volitional barriers, barriers of the will, that when a person understands the gospel, they realize the change in their life that it's going to mean to become a Christian. They might be resisting that. Spiritual barriers, because we have a very real enemy who doesn't want to see people come to faith. And then cultural barriers as well, that if we're talking across a different language group or a cultural group, if someone's coming from a different background where they have different values, that can make communication difficult. So there are barriers in the doctor's life, and there are also barriers in the patient's life that we need to be aware of. Let's think now about the keys to spiritual influence. And if we want to be effective in being witnesses and getting opportunities to talk about really important things with some of our patients, then these are the five keys. And you'll see, to make them easy to remember, they all begin with the letter C. So let's think about each one of those one at a time. The first C is professional competence. And we know, first of all, that excellence is an important value in the kingdom of God. It was said of Joseph, of Daniel, that he was neither negligent. He wasn't negligent, and he was faithful. He was a person of integrity. We know that Joseph was the same. They both got wonderful opportunities to share their faith, like Esther did as well. So if we want people to pay attention to our faith, we must first pay attention to our work. People don't care if you're a good person until they know that you're a good doctor. So you have to be well-trained and effective. And so this is why it is so important that in our undergraduate and postgraduate training, we make sure that we learn the necessary skills. There's nothing that destroys a witness more quickly than a bad doctor. And it's a tragedy when you see people who are keen, committed Christians, very much involved in a local church, but they have a bad reputation among colleagues, not because of their lifestyle, but because they're just not good at their work. And they make too many mistakes. And as the Bible tells us, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not as for human masters. So we live and work believing that it's for God that we do that work. So that's competence, the first spiritual key. The second one is a Christ-like character. It's not enough to practice good medicine. There has to be something attractive about you personally. So I'm sure we've all met doctors. I trained in surgery. I think there are perhaps an unusual number of doctors like this in surgery who were incredibly competent professionally, but they were just very unpleasant people, perhaps very arrogant, or they got angry, or they spoke in an uncivil way to patients. So it's not enough to practice good medicine, important though that is. There has to be something attractive about us personally. And what we're talking about here is character or Christ-likeness. The question, what would Jesus do? Or perhaps even more accurately here, how would Jesus do this? And when we think about character, it's the fruit of the Holy Spirit in a person's life that draw people. Christ said if he was lifted up from the earth, he'd draw all people unto him. And when Christians demonstrate love, joy, peace, kindness, forbearance, goodness, all these fruit of the Spirit, then there is then something very attractive about them personally. I had a good friend as a junior doctor who was asked by a patient who had a terminal illness, and his wife. They were relatively young people in their 30s. And one day she came into see them in the medical ward behind the curtain, and they said, look, we're really thinking about the big questions of life after death, given what we're facing, and we know you're a believer, we've been watching you, and we really think you're a person that we can talk to. And we wonder if you could give us some time to talk about those big questions. And of course, she was very competent in her work, but what really spoke to them was the fragrance of Christ that she exuded whenever she went around the ward. People could see Jesus in her, and so they thought that they could trust her with big questions. The third key is compassion. The logical end of grace. In other words, if we really understand what God's done for us as sinners, how he emptied himself and took the form of a servant and gave us through his death and resurrection the salvation we don't deserve, if we really understand that, then we will want to be compassionate with others and treat them the same way. And compassion involves both our speech and our actions. It's the way we talk to people. Are we gentle and kind? Do we or do we get angry and impulsive? How do our actions display compassion? Are we gentle the way we handle patients, or do we hurt them? I remember once when I was training in orthopedics, I hurt a patient very badly manipulating a fracture when he wasn't properly anesthetized. And I had to go back later and apologize to him for what I'd done. And it really damaged our relationship until I apologized to him. So our compassion involves both our speech and our actions. People don't care how much we know until they know how much we care. And God himself is the father of all compassion, who comforts us in all our troubles. And part of the reason he does that, as we're told here in 2 Corinthians, is so that we, having received his comfort, can give others his comfort as well. So competence, character, compassion. And number four is communication, wise communication. It's not enough just to live a good life. Francis of Assisi apparently said, "I share Christ with everyone I meet, and occasionally I use words." In other words, he was saying that it was really just his life that was important. And I was at a Christian leaders meeting once where someone said, "When I get to heaven, I'm going to find St. Francis of Assisi and strangle him because of all the people he gave an excuse to for never sharing their faith in words." And I remember hearing a story of a missionary doctor who worked in Southeast Asia and served in a hospital doing wonderful medicine with great compassion and great competence for many years. And at the end of that time, the local people said that he was a good Buddhist. And why would they say that? Well, it was because he never, ever talked about Jesus. He never talked about the ideas that inspired his behavior. And sadly, he never gave the credit to God for what he did, so that people thought he was the good one. So we need to communicate in words as well, but that communication needs to be wise. And as the Apostle Peter says, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect. We need to use words in a wise way. Competence, character, compassion, communication, and then the final C is courage, because it does take courage to share our faith. And if we pray, God will provide opportunities, but then we have to grasp those opportunities. And when we sense an opportunity, it takes courage to open our mouths to speak. And this is why even the apostles themselves prayed for boldness, because they didn't have it within themselves to share their faith without the courage that God's Holy Spirit brings. And so often in the Bible, you know, the most common command that God gives in the whole Bible is, do not be afraid, do not be afraid. Be strong and courageous, encourage one another. Because it's so easy, isn't it, for us to be afraid about sharing our faith and then use that as an excuse not to. So there's the five C's of spiritual influence. Now let's just think about some tools for witness. And again, we're not going to be able to look at many of these, and we'll go through them fairly quickly. And part of this thing is to encourage you to do the whole Saline process course. But in the Saline process, they'll give you 8 keys altogether. And we're just going to look at 3 or 4 of these, the first ones. And I'll just give you an overview of what these keys are. So tool number one is prayer. And we can pray, and we must pray, because when we do pray, God opens doors. Even the Apostle Paul asked the Colossians, please pray so that God will open a door for the gospel, because he recognized, even though he was an apostle, how weak he was and how he needed the Holy Spirit's help to create opportunities for him to be able to share his faith. So what we should be doing is just cultivating what Brother Lawrence called the presence of Christ, so that all the way through, whenever we're working in the wards and our clinics, it is in an attitude of prayer, and that we're sending up little arrow prayers to God. God, help me put in this drip, help me take this blood, help me take this history. Prayers that we just say quietly to him for our workplace, for our patients, for our colleagues, with our colleagues, and for ourselves to take opportunity. So there's the quote from Colossians: pray for us that God may open a door for our message, so that I might proclaim the mystery of Christ. Amazing there that the apostle was asking very young Christians, but he knew the power of their prayers. And there will be opportunities too to pray with your patients. Again, it's the SPR of sensitivity, permission, and respect. And the Holy Spirit can be a great help to us here. And when it's not right, we will generally feel him. We'll have a sense that it's not right to take this opportunity. And then when it is, we'll feel him prompting us to do it. So there will be times, of course, we should be praying for our patients regardless, when they're not there, when we're away from them, when we're walking to and from them silently. But there will be times too when patients will welcome prayer as part of what we're doing. Now, obviously, if someone is a Christian already, or you see a Bible sitting on a side desk or a side table, then that will be a prompt to ask about it. You know, would you like me to pray for you? It might be that there are people of other faiths, and Muslims will often welcome prayer. And of course, it should never be imposed, but always asked in a sensitive way. And if the patient says, no, thank you, then that's absolutely fine. You do not push it at all, but you may get the opportunity to do it. The people who know their God will display strength and take action, because it takes courage as well. So there's number one tool is prayer. Now, number two tool is the asking of questions. And I think often as Christians, we feel we have to be telling people things, when often it's far more effective to be asking them questions which help them to reflect and come up with answers themselves, or realize perhaps that there are questions they need to be asking of themselves. And we think of God himself. He was a great asker of questions. Think of the first chapters of Genesis, some of the questions God asked: who told you were naked? Or to Cain, where is your brother? Remember that question. Or think of Jesus, or think of God at the end of the book of Job, where he spends about three chapters asking question after question of Job. And Job, through the asking of the questions and realizing he doesn't know the answers, comes into a much stronger and more real relationship with God. Or think of the way Jesus modeled communication, often through asking questions. And notice that Jesus often didn't answer the questions that he was asked either, but he often asked questions. What do you want me to do for you? He'd say to someone who was not healing, what was wanting healing. Because questions build relationships and they help us to know our patients far better. Of course, in order to make a diagnosis, we have to ask a whole set of questions. But in order to know spiritual needs and tailor our gospel presentation appropriately, we have to as well. And sometimes the Holy Spirit will prompt us to ask a question. We'll look at some of those questions later, but I remember when I was working as a junior doctor in an accident and emergency department, we had a patient come in who tried to kill himself by carbon monoxide poisoning in a car. I learned that this man had lost his family, who had died, and he was desperate, and he connected the exhaust to his car and he tried to kill himself. And I did all the medical things, and I felt the Holy Spirit prompting me to go a bit deeper than that. And so I said to God, well, what should I say to him? And he said, well, why didn't you ask him a question? I said, well, what question? And the question that came into my mind was, just ask him, do you believe in God? And I said to God, well, that's a silly question. How can I ask that? He said to me, well, you just go and ask the question and see what happens. And so So I said to this guy, after I was talking with him afterwards, I said, look, do you mind if I ask you a personal question? He said, no, not at all, it's fine. I said, do you believe in God? And I didn't quite know how he'd react, but he said to me, you know, it's funny you should ask that question, because that's the whole problem. Because last night, before I tried to kill myself, I said to God, I'm going to kill myself. Just you try and stop me. And so I said, well, it looks like God successfully stopped you, because what had happened was that the car had stalled and the gas had stopped, and someone saw him in the car with the exhaust coming out and pulled him out and saved him. And that's why he was in hospital. He would have died. And I said to him, you know, perhaps God did stop you. And he said, look, yes, it looks like he did, didn't it? And so we had a wonderful conversation there in the accident and emergency department. And it started all just because I asked a question that opened him up at that time. So think about questions. We'll come back to that, particularly with this issue, the spiritual history. We're used to taking histories from patients. We ask about the history of the present illness, the family history, we ask the functional inquiry, lots of other questions about other parts of their health. And you can slip in also the spiritual history question, and we'll come back to looking at what those are. But if we're going to practice whole person medicine that really discovers spiritual risk factors and helps patients cope with sickness and pain and enhances healthcare outcomes, then we have to be thinking much more than the physical. Find out the real problem behind it. I remember a man who had a fractured femur. He'd been walking across the road and he was knocked over, came in, and we fixed up his leg by putting a rod down it. And when I went more deeply into the history, I'd learned that the reason he broke his leg was because he walked across the road without looking. And the reason he did that was because he was drunk. And the reason he was drunk was because he'd been to the pub drinking huge amounts of beer. And the reason for that was because he'd had a fight with his wife. And the reason he'd had a fight with his wife is that she'd just found out he'd been having an affair. And so the real problem was not the broken leg. That was just the symptom of it. The real problem was the breakdown of their marriage because of the way which he'd been behaving. And if I hadn't asked the right questions, I would never have found out those things or being able to address the real problem. So when might we take a spiritual history? Well, we can do it in lots of different circumstances. If you're doing a health maintenance examination where you're asking lots of questions about the health, to slip one or two in about spiritual things, particularly at times when they're thinking about big issues with terminal or major illness, and they might be more open to questions about spiritual things. In the perioperative period, before an operation or just after, often when they're more open, or at a time of social crisis or a time of loss. And in all of these situations, we need to be careful to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, to pray for opportunities and to be aware when he prompts us to take them. Now, how do you take a spiritual history? Well, there are three types of question that you can ask. And the way to do it is that you just put it into the normal questions that you're asking. So you might have taken the history of their present illness. Perhaps it's the history of a cough, how it developed, what sort of cough it is, whether it's productive, whether it's any blood or whatever. And then you've asked the past history questions. Have you ever had any past operations or illnesses? And then, has anyone in the family had anything like this? And then you ask a spiritual history question. And the one I like best is the first one here. Do you have a faith that helps you in a time like this? Or you could add, or you're not interested in these things, to give them an out. Do you have a faith which helps you in a time like this when you're facing difficulty? Just slot it in. If you get an answer, or yes, I'm a Catholic, or I'm a Buddhist, no, I'm an atheist, or I'm a Christian, or whatever, it's going to tell you something about the patient that you can tuck away and come back to. Do you have a personal faith, or what's important to you personally, even more vague? Or questions about practice. How does your faith affect your life? Or have you ever prayed about your situation? You can just slip these seamlessly into the questions that you're asking. Or questions about a faith community. Do you belong to a faith community? You see, you're not here implying that they must be Christian. They might say, no, I'm a Hindu. Yes, I'm a Hindu. Or, well, I'm a humanist, but we gather with other like-minded people. Or, well, I get my support at the golf club from the other people who play golf. But we're finding more about the real person behind the illness. Belief, practice, faith community. And then finally, final tool we're just going to touch on again is what's called a faith flag. And this is where you indicate in the course of a conversation by the things you say, or sometimes the things you do, that you are a person to whom faith means something. And faith flags occur as a natural part of the conversation. They take no more than 30 seconds. It's just a few words. They identify you as a member of God's family. They look for but do not demand a response. And they create opportunities. So they don't leave the patient in any position where they have to make a response at all, but their freedom to do if they want to. And then later they can create opportunities. So very simply, you might say, well, wasn't it a beautiful weekend? I relaxed on Saturday and after church on Sunday, we went for a walk in the park. And that was amazing how many people were out there on such a beautiful day. Now, you just slipped in the fact that you went to church on Sunday. That's a faith flag. Or it might be that you have in your practice, in your clinic, just a poster on the wall with a Bible verse on it. That can equally be a faith flag. Or just that you talk about things like providence, or, you know, isn't this a blessing? So the kind of language that's perhaps going to identify you as a member of God's family. They should not become a spiritual turnoff, include theological language, like the people aren't going to understand. Create any embarrassing situation. Identify you with denominations or groups. It's not about, you know, I'm a Catholic or I'm a premillennial evangelical or I'm a Baptist or whatever. It's just very simply that I'm a person with faith in Jesus Christ. And that don't list do's and don'ts or leave people with obligations that make them feel uncomfortable. So there we are. There's a quick introduction to some of the things in saline process. Explore the personal, know about your patients, listen for expressions of felt needs, don't react negatively to objections, recognize the value of doubt, answer their sincere questions, turn their questions into a faith story. That's something else that you'll learn on the course. And possibly you might get chances to and investigate things more deeply together.